Your Family's Health is a program that focuses on health care issues and resources available here in Nassau County. On the show, we will be speaking to experts from around the country to keep you up to date on current health care issues and trends. Today, we will be speaking to Dian Griesel about silver disobedience. So if you want to know more about how to stay healthy in Nassau County, stay tuned for the next half hour to the voice of Nassau Community College, 90.3 WHPC. Welcome to the show, Dian.
Thank you, Dr. Jeanine.
So tell me about yourself and the company that you founded, Silver Disobedience.
Well, Silver Disobedience started when my dearest friend, who is 20 years older than me, and we've been best friends for 30 years, ended up in the hospital and was very ill. I will say she's fine now, but it was very disturbing to me because anyone who knows her would describe her as the youngest person we all know, even though she's 77. And it prompted me to wonder, was age an attitude or a number?
And this friend that you have, was she a part of starting the company, or was this
she
something
wasn't,
that...
But I would say she was the impetus, because looking at her in her hotel room, where I will say the nurses, the hospital staff, everyone was fantastic, but she was in serious... she had three different surgeries over a seven-week period. And a lot of the time was completely out of it, you know, doped up on different pain medications as she needed to be at that time. And it was such a shock to see someone who for 30 years I considered a major life force not being lively. And it was the first time I had to confront her age, and I'm 57 and she's 77, and it was a shock to me. So I started to write about aging and what does it mean and what is life and what changes over the years? How are we perceived differently at each stage we go through, particularly after age 50?
What is silver disobedience? We had to sum it up. What is it?
Yeah. Silver disobedience is a play on words. Obviously, we're all law-abiding citizens, as the civil disobedience movement was. But we're silvers, whether we color it, whether we let it show, whether it's white, gray, or if we don't have any more of it because we've gone bald or lost it from chemotherapy. So it's a play on words as to aging and re-looking at the rules. Do we really have to act a certain age? Was there some point we were supposed to change? What are the rules of aging? Who set them? Why do we have to follow them? And when did they even start?
Mm-hmm. That's very true. So what in your thoughts are the common myths about aging? We talk about ageism, but what are the common myths?
One of the most fascinating common myths to me about aging is that we all cross a certain age and we're retired, we're kind of sitting around, we've started to dress a certain way, we don't really care so much for our bodies anymore. That's a big myth. There are some facts. The over 50 population is unlike any other that has ever existed before in the history of this country and likely the world, because of second marriages, adoptions that are happening worldwide, children from all other countries and this country being adopted by families in later life, as well as in vitro fertilization. We have a population that could be 50 and up, not just taking care of grandchildren and changing diapers for others' children. They could be changing diapers for their own children. So instead of withdrawing from certain markets, we are a group that's expanding into markets that we've never before been in. Mm-hmm. And it's a wake-up call in many ways for a lot of people.
Mm-hmm.
I know also work as a model, and I will go into castings, and they will immediately pair me up with, let's say, a 30-year-old as my daughter, when the fact is I have a 14- and 17-year-old. Mm-hmm. That I gave birth to.
Yeah. You're a Wilhelmina Icon model, I should add to that. So
I am.
So you're in media, and you do see the, would you call it ageism that occurs? Would you call it ageism, the stereotypic view of what you're supposed to behave, how you're supposed to behave, and what you're supposed to be doing at a certain age? Would you call it that, or would you just say that it is just a stereotypic view that we have as a society about those who get older?
You know, Dr. Jeanine, I'm glad you broke that down very much. You know, ageism, I think, is a negative term, and I prefer to look at everything from the positive perspective. I think it's more like, let's not label it as a negative. Let's just raise the positive and let people understand that we haven't stopped living. We don't stop living at a certain age. That's a choice. Age is a choice that someone makes. You could be 14 years old and be a very old person. Mm-hmm. Or you could be 90 and be an old person or a young person. We all know the people that are young at heart. So to me, it's a lot about choices. And ageism falls in because people, I don't think, are really looking at who others are.
Mm-hmm. So this may be the category of baby boomers born between the year of 64, 46 through 64, that group, that age group population, or even before?
Correct.
Okay.
Because my mother is 89, and her husband, who we all adore, is 83. And I would call them ultimate examples of silver disobedience. Mm-hmm. They are still living life to the maximum and could run circles around plenty of people I know that are younger.
And the population, we're seeing more people in above the age of 50, would you agree, than in years past? Because people are living longer due to a lot of the preventative medicine that we have. What is the most surprising thing about aging that you've learned?
Oh, there have been so many. I would say the big thing that is fascinating me, and I guess you could say it's surprising, is the number of ways that people look at what I would call the second act of their lives. And I've always believed you never know when the second half of your life begins. I recently wrote a blog on a lot of people say, oh, I'm at 50, I'm halfway through my life. Yet at the same time, they think they're only going to live to 75. Mm-hmm. So either we should pay more attention in math, or maybe we need to relook at how we view it.
Yeah.
And so I think one of the big surprises is how people either say, I don't know if I have the energy for this, or they're saying, you know what? Now's the best time for me to start a new business, take a class, learn something I never knew, learn to dance, learn to belly dance, paint a picture, join a band, take ballroom dancing. It is fantastic. And this is all while plenty of people are working, starting new businesses, doing things that they maybe viewed as hobbies, and saying, I could actually make money on this.
Yeah.
I'm going to try it. So that enthusiasm is at an all-time high.
The enthusiasm to live. So it may be, you probably are not in the first chapter of your life, but the second chapter. After you retire, there's another chapter. There's another beginning, if you will. That's what I'm hearing from you.
Absolutely. And sometimes it's not even their second chapter. It could be their third or fourth due to relationships, moves around the country, job changes, complete career changes, death of a spouse. That just has served as a wake-up call. Illness is often a trigger where someone says, you know what? I have done this for years. I don't know how much longer I'm living, but I'm going to live it up and make sure I am appreciating everything that I have from here on out. It fascinates me.
It's very fascinating. So Silver Disobedience is a community of people who talk to you, who hire you. Tell me about that. Tell me about the community, that the Silver Disobedience community.
Well, you know, it's so funny. When I grew up back in the late 60s and 70s, because I was born in 61, we had one black and white TV, and we were only allowed to watch Walt Disney on Sunday nights. So when my father came home, he always bought the Long Island newspaper Newsday with him. And I could not wait to read it. Two things. I really wanted to read my horoscope, but I also loved Ann Landers. Mm-hmm. And my mother always joked with me. You know, people would write in their problems, and in three or four incredibly smart sentences, she summed things up. And my mother always teased me and said, someday you're going to be Ann Landers. So I laugh now, and I say, here I am at 57, and I think I'm finally, although I've had a wonderful career, I've worked in PR, public relations, in always advising people in some capacity or another my whole life, I'm having so much fun with Silver Disobedience because I think what's happened is by risking sharing what I meditate on and what I'm working on, and as the mother of two teenagers, I'm far from perfect on, and as a woman who's married and working and trying to keep myself married and sister to four other siblings with a mother, thank goodness, who's still alive and a father who I miss, I really think I've tapped into a collective consciousness. And I know for mm-hmm. some people that sounds flaky, but mm-hmm. I really do believe we're all more connected as humans than people might want to acknowledge.
I agree.
And I'm writing about things that sometimes I feel very exposed about. I worry that my PR clients might think, uh-oh, she's gone over the deep end. But instead, they're embracing it. I have more clients now that call me up and say, I can't believe what you wrote. I felt like you were in my head. Mm. And what's happened is now people are sharing their thoughts back. I feel like I'm in a daily group therapy session that I shared first, and everyone came back with love and their experiences. And what's so fascinating, Dr. Jeanine, is that they not only share their experiences, others don't just comment on what I said, they're commenting on what everyone else said with support. Mm-hmm. So if someone is experiencing pain, and I mean, I can tell you who's had a death of a child or lost a spouse that they loved or different things, all these personalities are coming to a surface, and it's building. We're over 100,000 people now between my Instagram page at Silver Disobedience or Facebook at Silver Disobedience or right on the blog or on Twitter or Pinterest. But on Facebook and Instagram, the conversations are incredible. And there are men and women really connecting on a heartfelt level.
Mm-hmm. Excellent.
And you think social media can be really shallow? And let me tell you, I often wonder, can the Tao or being humble exist when you post a picture of yourself every day, which mm-hmm. is what I'm doing. Mm-hmm. I'm the one in those pictures. But the passionate conversation that develops, it's been the most heartwarming thing mm-hmm. I can really say I think I've ever done.
Was it difficult?
Besides, let me ask you. You know, loving my kids.
That's true. Was it difficult, Diane, telling your age? I know for women, we, you know, Silver Disobedience, and I know that's the name of the company, but was it hard? I know you're a model and you're in media. Was that hard to just divulge your age?
Very interesting question. In modeling, they tell you always don't tell your age, right. Just give them an age range. So when you go to a shoot or a casting and they say, well, what's your age here? And they want you to give a range of, let's say, 47 to 57 or 47 to 60, whatever you think you fall in. But my daughter, who's 17, teased me because one day she asked me what year I was born. And I said 61. And she said, Mom, you told me you were 57 2 years ago. And I said, well, I guess I was preparing myself for the shock of that. So to be, it's all a number. And I lived through September 11th downtown and lost a lot of very dear friends. I've lived through four